2803, representing the Netherlands. In absentia, can you please give him a big cheer? Erik Simon Streek.
And that makes the racing even more special. But yeah, quit whilst you're still in love with it, I think. And it will be hard, and you know, I was quite sad at the end, crossing the line, knowing that that would be the last time I would win in Bolton. But it made it even more special.
Can you imagine? That way to an 11-time Ironman champion, one of the most winning British ladies over the Iron distance, actually. You're right up there, there's only a handful of you. Bella, Chrissy, you.
I think probably it will only sink in when you stop. Like, you have these experiences and so many people know you and so many people are shouting your name, and whenever it's tough, there's always people are cheering and things. You know, riding on a motorbike, I think you'll only appreciate it when you finally stop it. You always take it for granted, and knowing that it's my last year, I think every time I race, good races or bad races, I appreciate how special it is, perhaps more than I did before.
We're going to turn to your amazing champion, Jill Skipper. How did it feel running down the finish line yesterday and breaking the tape as the new champion? First time Ironman win here in the UK.
Oh, it's absolutely amazing, yeah. Something I've wanted to do since I first did the race in 2013. But yeah, to finally finish on the top step is, yeah, it's like a dream come true, really.
And Joe, we were watching you with some apprehension at one point because I believe you had a mechanical on the bike. But did you have a mechanical or some issues with your bike on the bike course?
Yeah, I hit a bit of a rough patch on the road and my bar came loose. So I had to get an Allen key off one of the motorbikers and tighten them up a bit because one bar was down here, the other one was up there.
A little bit lopsided, not good for trying to win a race. So then you really ran yourself into that top step on the podium. You were running so hard on the course, the cameraman could barely keep up with you.
Thanks, but I don't know about that. Yeah,
a 2:45 marathon was quite fast yesterday.
Yeah, I've just got it. I just know, like, I've got a strategy now for the running Ironman. I know what works for me. You know, I don't get carried away and start off too quick. I like to build into it, so I take it a bit easy on the first lap, and then second lap I pick it up a bit more, and then I try and push the third lap even harder, and then the fourth lap I see where I am, you know, and if I need to dig in, then that's where I do it, or you know, just try and consolidate and hold the pace.
We could see on the big screen at the finish line how your demeanour almost changed on the fourth lap. It was like as if you kind of knew you had it in the bag almost, and your stride, your posture, everything, you were just absolutely nailing it to that finish. You were a champion on the way to the finish line.
Yeah, well, once I'd dropped the guy, Mark, in second, I thought I didn't want him to come back to me, and I thought I was so close to getting the win, I thought I've just got to seal the deal, you know, and yeah, just keep pushing on, and once I saw it with 5k to go, I knew really in my head that I had it then, but you're never quite sure, are you, you know, like you always think, oh, what if, you know, what if I get like a stitch, or if I get cramp, or something like that, but I felt a lot better when I saw that I had about a 3 or 4 minute buffer then, but yeah, it made me work for it.
And of course the crowds around the Bolton Town Centre, the crowds on the run course, they must have been amazing for you as well, for the support.
Yeah, that really did help me. The support out there was unbelievable, and I think that gave me the edge over Mark, because unfortunately for him, he's German and he's racing in England, and I'm English racing in England, so I got all the support I needed, which helped a lot.
Well, listen, ladies and gentlemen, your men's champion, Joe Skipper.
By the way, Lucy Russell would like to have the final word.
Sorry, I can only imagine how tough it's been the last few weeks trying to get this race sorted. And I think everyone who raced will agree that the team did an amazing job. And thing to say is Joe's finish time was pretty much identical to his time in Roth 2 weeks ago. So it was a tough course, and congratulations to the team, because I
haven't wanted to be
in your place 2 weeks ago.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Lucy. To the Kona slots now. We have 14 of those for you to achieve your Kona dreams. Do we have anybody who wants to go to Hawaii? Right, superb. Anybody been before to the World Championship? Who's here is hoping to go for the first time? It's properly amazing. It really is. It starts when you get on the plane to leave. I remember the first time I went, got to London Heathrow, and you could already see the compression socks and the bike bags and the water bottles and the backpacks, and you could feel that energy. Then you're on the plane, you can spot the triathletes from a mile away. And then you get to LA or San Francisco, which are the airports you decide to get to the US first, and then when you finally get out of that 5 million hour immigration queue, and you get your bag and you recheck and you go into the terminal that your airplane leaves from to go to Kona, it's just Ironman triathletes. It's unbelievable, and you feel that energy. And then you get on the plane, and then the captain comes on to does his very sexy usual captain's voice, even better in an American accent, and welcomes everybody aboard and tells you how long it's going to take to fly there, and then makes a special mention of the Ironman athletes going to do the World Championship, and then tells you that he's changed his schedule so that he can land in Kona on Saturday morning to cheer you on. That is the energy of going to Hawaii. And then usually the airplane is way too cold. I remember Joe Skipper and I actually sitting on the plane leaving Kona a few years ago, and we had two blankets each. But in any case, it's freezing cold on the airplane, and you land in Kona around about 8:30 at night typically. It's dark, and then they open the door, and there's no jetways at Kona Airport. Kona Airport is basically a pavement with a belt for your bags. That's about it, right? And you land, and they open the door, and this hot, humid air comes flooding in, and you immediately feel the spirit of Hawaii. It's very, very special. Congratulations to all those of you that are here who want to be able to say yes to achieve your dreams as we celebrate 40 years of dreams. We're going to get things ready in a moment, but before we do, we just want to show you a taster of what it's been like on the big island of Hawaii. It's the big island that gave the group of islands its name as the state of Hawaii. Kona, Kailua Kona is the town where we race. And we just want to give you a little bit of a taste of that. Cast your eyes to the big screen.
The first Hawaiian Ironman triathlon was held on the 18th of February in 1978.
2.4 miles to there, 112 mile bike ride, 26.2 mile run. Nobody would do this one day. Nobody would do it.
The feeling that you get when you arrive on that island is something like no other.
It has a spirit and a power of its own that seems to catapult athletes that want to quit in such the worst way to get to that finish line.
The goal has grown, and yet at its absolute core remains the same.
It's, to me, the greatest race in all of our sport. It's Ironman.
Understanding the athlete, we're not just a travel company supplying travel.